I too sing America. I am the darker brother. They send me to eat in the kitchen when company comes, but I laugh and eat well and grow strong. Tomorrow I'll be at the table when company comes. Nobody'll dare say to me, eat in the kitchen then. Besides, they'll see how beautiful we are and be ashamed. I too am America.
GIL, in my opinion, is one of the great, one of those great black writers of the 20th century.
You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to tune in, turn off, or cop out.
He had that capacity, like Chuck D had later on, to, you know, reach the masses, rock the boulevard.
There will be no pictures of pigs shooting down brothers on the instant replay. There will be no pictures of pigs shooting down brothers on the instant replay.
As far as I was concerned, he was the lone prince of the revolution.
There will be no pictures of you and Willie Mae pushing that shopping cart down the block on the dead run.
He represents the elder statesman and the man on the corner at the same time.
The revolution will not be right back after a message about a white tornado, white lightning, or white people.
So was he direct? Absolutely. Was he provocative? Absolutely.
The revolution will not give your mouth sex appeal. The revolution will not make you 5 pounds thinner.
He's managed to both create a legacy and, you know, still be this living, performing artist in spite of everything he's been through.
This revolution is not a rerun, brothers. This revolution is live.
Am I blue? Am I blue?
I was born in Chicago and on April Fool's Day, April 1st, 1949. I come from a combination of a black man from Jamaica and a black woman from Jackson, Tennessee. My mother and father were having problems getting along with each other, and my mother was going to have to reorganize herself, relocate. She had my grandmother take me back to Tennessee with her. So I arrived in Jackson in late in 1950 and was there through 1962. My father was the first black player for Celtic, probably the first black player in Scotland. They referred to him as the Black Arrow. He scored a goal, the first game he played over there. I think that might have saved his life, ain't no telling.
Could be a spoon full of diamond. Could be a spoon full of gold.
It was our grandparents that gave us the foundations in those days. Our grandparents were the people who been through it all, came from another country to this country, understood more than one way of living.
I was a great believer that my grandmother knew everything. And my grandmother was fond of Langston Hughes. She used to point out his column in the weekly black paper.
GIL is definitely a devotee of Langston Hughes's work, and particularly, you know, these short stories he wrote called the Jesse B. Simple. Jess is like a working class brother who's got all kind of issues and problems, you know, with his woman, with his job, with working, with money, you know, with his landlord, you know what I mean? They're just real slice of life stories.
At that time, it was something that we appreciated, because the least educated, the least respected, the least appreciated characters in those stories always came out on top.
They call it Stormy Monday, but Tuesday's just as bad.
I come from the blues. I am a blues artist, a bluesist, and I come from that type of attitude. I come from Tennessee.
If you're gonna be brought up in the South, then you know that you got the blues right at your hip.
B.B. King and to Bobby Blue Bland and to Lightning Hopkins and to John Lee Hooker.
In the world of Beale Street, you know, out of which the B.B. Kings and Howlin' Wolves and all those people came out of in the 50s, was really part of kind of a a separate and, if not equal, self-sufficient, you know, African-American community of the 50s.
My mother had been involved with the NAACP, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. When that organization moved into Jackson, the primary purpose of it was to advance the educational process. One problem with Jackson, as it was with many places in the South, was that the schools were segregated. In 1962, along with a guy named Gillard Glover and a girl named Madeline Walker, I was one of the three who integrated the school system in Jackson, Tennessee. I was aware of the fact that some changes needed to be made. I learned that on the front porch at night when my grandmother and other people would talk about what the situations were and what needed to be done, that there were some inequities there and we were somehow on the lower end of it right through there, and we were trying to do something about that. I learned that at a very early age.
Someone who has seen the effects of Jim Crow and suffers the scars of Jim Crow can write about it better than someone who hasn't.
Alabama's got me so upset. Tennessee made me lose my rest. Everybody knows about Mississippi, goddamn.
My grandmother died the night John Kennedy was elected. My mother moved back to Jackson, and then she made arrangements with her brother for us to move to the Bronx in New York. They were building this this new project, new low-income housing project in the Chelsea neighborhood, which had almost no blacks. It was a Puerto Rican and white neighborhood. I used to tell people that my neighborhood was 85% Puerto Rican, 15% white folks, and me. Because that's how it was.
I come from 17th Street, and that's on the other side of town.
If you've ever heard the song 17th Street, that's probably the most accurate depiction of what it was like in Chelsea at that time.
Come from 17th Street, and that's where the brothers don't mess around. And if they're thinking about the music, and we find out you can use it, you know.
With the sounds of salsa music with Joe Bataan and Joe Cuba and Tito Puente.
In the summertime, the drums came out, and brothers would be jamming all night long. You know, a lot of people learned how to play percussion doing an apprenticeship there in the park.
Live with a feeling of young folks trying to get somewhere. We were all trying to get to somewhere else, out of Chelsea for the most part.
Them niggas ain't playing.
Them niggas ain't playing.
Them niggas ain't playing.
Them niggas ain't playing.
Let us agree that the blow must be struck. And let us agree what type of blow must be struck and at whom the blow should be struck. And then those who don't go along with that strike, we can struck them first.
In the second half of the 1960s, the atmosphere in Harlem was revolution. It was about trying to create change, raising levels of consciousness. It was cool to be black and proud at that time.
Say it louder. Say it louder.
The word black was new. We had just gotten over Negro and colored, you know, and decided we could all call ourselves black and agree on that.
The black arts movement was the impetus for a lot of different artist groups to emerge and to come into existence in a period when we were just having a field day with our blackness.
It was the time of Malcolm X. It was the time of Dr. King's controversial attitude about how things needed to be done in the South. All these things were starting to be brought to you live on your living room television during dinner.
Well, the Black Arts Movement was a movement of poets and visual artists and dancers and musicians who had decided that we were going to use our art as a major weapon to attack the oppressive system.
Our movement aims to give Afro-Americans a sense of purpose.
We aim at a world revolution of black and colored rising against former slave masters.
GIL, he's practically, you know, a teenager, you know, when this is happening, but he's assimilating, you know, the politics and the form. And at the same time, you know, he's developing his craft as a musician as well, you know, I mean, as a pianist, as a songwriter.
I don't want nobody to give me nothing. Open up the door.
I got ready to go to college. I was looking for some place that I could help that would help me develop as a writer.
Lincoln University was one of the universities that just seemed to magnetize many brothers and sisters who wanted to think.
Langston Hughes and Melvin Tolson and Thurgood Marshall and Kwame Nkrumah, among others, had been students at Lincoln University.
From river to river, uptown and down, there's liable to be confusion when a dream gets kicked around. You talk like they don't kick dreams around downtown. I expect they do, but I'm talking about Harlem to you.
I went to Lincoln University for one reason, Langston Hughes.
He was a Renaissance man. He wrote songs, he wrote poetry, he wrote columns, he wrote essays, and as a writer myself, I knew that you couldn't use just one form and get every idea across.
At Lincoln, I did meet some incredible, incredible people, and one of them was GIL, and I felt like, okay, well, I met my Langston Hughes.
A rat done bit my sister Nell with Whitey on the moon. Her face and arms began to swell, and Whitey's on the moon. I can't pay no doctor bills, but Whitey's on the moon. 10 years from now, I'll be paying still while Whitey's on the moon.
I first met GIL at Lincoln University as a freshman.
And I was working with a guy named Victor Brown.
Victor introduced me to GIL while GIL was playing in one of the rooms. And GIL was working on some of his songs.
Brian was looking in on us one day, watching what we were doing.
And I was thinking, man, this guy writes great songs.
We talked for a little while, and Brian said he had written some compositions, some music that he felt might work well with some lyrics.
So I sat down to play a couple of things, and it was just like that. It just kind of clicked.
Victor Brown was wanting to put a band together, and the name of the group was Black and Blues.
We had so many people that we used to love to listen to. Al Green, Isaac Hayes, the whole Watts Stax thing, Otis Redding, Jimi Hendrix, Aretha Franklin. We would also listen to John Coltrane.
You're looking for an individual voice when you play. You want something that you can identify immediately as theirs. There are a lot of saxophone players and a lot of singers, and you recognize John Coltrane immediately. You recognize Billie Holiday immediately. You like to feel as though the musician put some of themselves and some of their individual talent into a particular song or idea, and you get that with Coltrane. There was a lot of tension on the campuses that we went to, and on Howard University's campus and Morgan State and some other places that we came in contact with, and found out that a lot of the same kind of tension was happening there.
But are you really ready for black pop? Have you thought about where you're at? Are you really ready for black power? And are you sure your mind is black? Now listen.
I just want to do God's will. And he's allowed me to go up to the mountain. And I've looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you, But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land.
Dr. King was important because he stood for things that we all believed were significant. Better education, better jobs, better places to live.
When I was in college at Drake University, I remember a white boy walking up to me saying, "Why is Dr. King complaining all the time?" I punched him in the face without any thought about anything. The death of Martin Luther King changed my mood, changed my ideas, changed everything for me almost immediately.
The main focal point was taken away with the assassination of Dr. King. So people kind of aspired and listened to culture and the music to send us messages of where to go.
It was after King's death that the last poets were born. When the revolution comes, transit cops will be crushed by the trains after losing their guns, and blood will run through the streets of Harlem, drowning anything without substance when the revolution comes. And we had a gig at Lincoln University. Gil Scott was the student body representative. And when he brought us on stage. And after we did our thing, Gil Scott came backstage and he asked me specifically, says, "Look, man, I want to start a group like you guys. When the revolution comes, Afros gonna be trying to straighten their heads, and straighten heads gonna be trying to wear Afros when the revolution comes." So I didn't know what Gil did. I didn't have any idea of what he could do. All I knew is that he was an eager young brother who wanted to do what we were doing.
The Last Poets did a real specific thing. There was music in there to the extent that, particularly in the early albums, there was, you know, Kunga players, you know, and they were doing a kind of long form spitfire poetry, very much influenced by, I think, you know, the solos of John Coltrane, you know, as well as the, you know, the rhetoric and polemic of Malcolm X.
Gil Scott was the link between Train and Malcolm X because his work represented both. He did not bite his tongue about what he said. He was Gil Scott was very eloquent in his poetry and his delivery.
"You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out. You will not be able to lose yourself on Skag and skip out for beer during commercials because the revolution will not be televised."
So Gil Scott Heron taking it from the Last Poets and the Watts Prophets and from James Brown and Curtis Mayfield, you know, pretty much saying, "Okay, yeah, let's keep it together, but this is what's out there, so make sure you got your eyes and your ears open."
"The revolution will not be televised, will not be televised, not be televised."
Gil also wrote, you know, two novels as well. You know what I mean? It was The Nigger Factory and then The Vulture.
I wrote The Vulture when I was 19. This is cool. It's a book that I quit school for a while to write. It was about the death of a drug dealer in the old Chelsea neighborhood.
These emerged around the same time as, you know, as the first album.
The Nigger Factory was about a rebellion on a black college campus and the animosities that it brings up between administrators and executives and students.
He was very much, I think, concerned with translating those literary ideals and literary forms and the politics of the time, you know, into a mass cultural form, into something that had the possibility of being played on the radio.
This was 125th and Lenox, and it was the most important corner in Harlem. And Harlem was the most important city in black America. And there was a poem that I'd written, and the poem was called "Small Talk at 125th and Lenox."
"Did you ever eat cornbread and black-eyed peas, or watermelon and mustard greens? Get high as you can on Saturday night, go to church on Sunday to set things right."
And when the people who were publishing my book, the Vulture, read some of the poems that I'd written, they asked me if I had any more. So I pulled out a suitcase full and said, "Yeah, of course I got more. Do I have more?" Picture a man of nearly 30 who appears twice as old, with clothes torn and dirty. Give him a job shining shoes or cleaning out toilets with bus station crews. Give him 6 children with nothing to eat and expose him to life on a ghetto street. Tie an old rag around his wife's head and have her pregnant lying in bed. Put all 8 people in a Harlem house and then tell them how bad things are down south.
Gil actually got the deal with Flying Dutchman. Bob, at that particular time, was was quite intent on recording some spoken word. So he got Gil to do Small Talk at 125th and Lennox.
Junkies is all right when they ain't broke. They leaves you alone when they high on dope. Damn, but I wish I could get up and move. Shut up, hell, you know that ain't true.
That time I had already written When the Revolution Comes, and I said, when the revolution comes, you know, some of us will probably catch it on TV with chicken hanging from our mouths. You'll know it's revolution because there won't be no commercials. And Gil Scott took it to the next level. He said, the revolution will not be televised.
The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by Xerox in four parts without commercial interruptions.
He wrote it as a piece of satire. Watching television would not accomplish anything. That the change that we were looking for was going to take place in their mind, not on the television sets.
The revolution will be no rerun, brothers. The revolution will be live.
The results from that gave Brian and I the opportunity to record Pieces of a Man.
That he was only talking to him. Pieces of a Man.
I was absolutely in awe of Bob Thiel, because Bob Thiel, after all, was the man who had produced a lot of the John Coltrane sessions for Impulse.
Or could you call on Lady Day? Could you call on John Coltrane?
He says to me, well, who do you want? I'm like, what do you mean? And he says, well, like, what musicians do you want on this? Tongue in cheek, I say, okay, well, you know, I want Ron Carter and, you know, I want Hubert Laws and this one and that one. Well, he calls back in a few days and he says, okay, I got these guys, you ready to go? And I was like, oh God, now what did I do?
You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out. You will not be able to lose yourself on Skag and skip out for beer during commercials, because the revolution will not be televised.
You could dance on the dance floor and, you know, kind of miss a couple of the words. When you sat down and read them, they had the kind of resonance that, you know, is really poetry as much as it is song or just song lyrics.
The revolution will not show you pictures of Nixon blowing a bugle and leading a charge by John Mitchell, General Abramson, and Spiro Agnew to eat hog maws confiscated from a Harlem sanctuary. The revolution will not be televised.
I was pretty much amazed that somebody was able to compress and combat so much imagery and so much ideology of cultural nationalism, you know, into such a witty kind of pop single.
The revolution will not be televised, will not be televised, will not be televised, will not be televised. The revolution will be no rerun, brothers. The revolution will be live.
Revolution was definitely an idea that was in the air. The idea that there was an imminent black revolution was certainly not only in the minds of Gil's generation, but certainly in the minds of the FBI as well, which is why they created their counterintelligence program, COINTELPRO.
So when there was a movement afoot to bring about change, they had to have infiltrators, they had to have people come in.
The counterintelligence program being able to infiltrate black communities with an over excessive amount of drugs. All of a sudden it was everywhere. In the black community. You couldn't find it anywhere in the white community, but you find it everywhere in the black community.
Many of us were feeling like we were being watched.
Hell, that would have monitored me if I was them. I mean, like we were making some sense. But what do you do? Stop.
He probably underwent as much surveillance as certainly any public speaker in that time. Because, I mean, he's really functioning as, you know, musical prophet, poet, you know, but also activists at the same time.
Ain't it nice to fly? You're waving as soft clouds go by, but peace won't be still of its own free will.
By the time we had done Free Will and finished Free Will, we had a pretty good idea of what production was and thought maybe we should try it for ourselves. And so the next album we did was Winter in America, and was our first production.
And from the entrance, welcome to Brooklyn, and for the Buffalo home.
ones full of plans. Like the vultures circling beneath the dark clouds, looking for the rain. Yes, you've been looking for the rain.
I remember hearing it and thinking this was something that related not only to the people, you know, who had been listening when he wrote it in the 70s, but I was now, this was, you know, the mid-1990s, and a generation later, the same kinds of political messages applied.
It seemed like a winter in America. The truth is there ain't nobody fighting because, well, nobody knows what to say. Sisters save the babies. Yes, winter in America.
Winter in America is definitely one of the pieces that I treasure, because he says no one knows what to fight for, because no one knows what to save.
It was just a statement that Brian and I wanted to make, a thing that we wanted to do for us as well as for other people.
Uno, dos, tres, cuatro.
A lot of times when Gil would write a song, he would maybe need me to arrange it. And sometimes the song was like so perfect the way it was, like for instance, The Bottle. I wouldn't even think about revoicing it. I wouldn't even think about changing anything to it.
See that black boy over there running scared? This old man in the bottle. Well, now, he doesn't quit his 9 to 5. He's sick full time. Now he's hanging in the bottle.
I just thought it was perfect the way it was.
See that black boy over there running scared? His old man got a problem. Who's in the news? He done bought on nearly everything. His old woman waiting for the bottle.
If you go out dancing and the DJ doesn't play the bottle, sometime during that night, as they've told me, he's whack.
Of course, In the Bottle was a big deal, and that was the only hit that that was heard on the radio often. It was a very important piece because it's relevant then, it's relevant now.
I first heard about Gil Scott-Heron in about 1975.
Gil was the first artist to have signed with Arista. And I think Barry Manilow was second, and then Melissa Manchester. Hey, go figure.
I always felt that Gil could have a commercial career that would be born in the art, would be born in his art, would come obviously from his fire, from his passion, from the incredible power of his poetry and his pen.
Yes, and all I really want to say is that the problems come and go, but the sunshine seems to stay.
I think Clive Davis had probably heard about us after The Bottle. I think he always wished that we would do another bottle. Maybe he thought that we would do 10 bottles.
The frustration that I had is that I saw this future that would be larger in commercial sales than what he had been enjoying.
And just look around, I think we found a lovely day.
He really had a very specific idea of how each of his pieces and material would be recorded, and we were true to it.
Because I don't feel like believing everything I do gonna turn out wrong. Oh, when the vibrations I'm receiving say, hold on, brother, just you be strong.
What Gil and Brian Jackson and the Midnight Band were doing was so distinct. You know what I mean? Like, their way of, you know, putting together a groove or putting together a song, you know what I mean, definitely stood out.
And everybody got a pistol. Everybody got a 45. 22. Warning you, philosophy seemed to be at least as near as I can.
Christmas. There were elements afloat in Gil's music that maybe weren't necessarily so pronounced in others, you know, in terms of percussion, the politics, and, you know, the Coltrane inspiration.
I have been in the audience at shows where he has people doubled over with laughter because he's a humorist as well as a musician, a bluesologist, all of the other things he describes himself to be.
So I wanted to contribute myself. I was writing down and putting all the categories together. I ain't got no money, I ain't got no job blues, I ain't got no woman blues. And then I said, wait a minute. See, I don't want to waste no categories. I ain't got no money blues, I ain't got no job blues, I ain't got no woman blues. Hell, them the same thing. Because if I could get me a job, I could make me some money, I could call me a lady. I'd be doing a whole bunch better.
He had a way of making people laugh at the actuality. I don't even call it reality. He made people laugh at actuality. And this is what's happening.
When it comes down to Gil Scott-Heron and Yuma, it's just a reflection of how we kick it as people. You know, coming from the down south area when he was young, number one, you know, you just, everything isn't straight up and down like of the cold north. So there's always a smile, there's always a joke or two with a plate of food and then saying something serious to tell you to watch your back. It comes out of those elements. I mean, the blues isn't all sad.
You know, but when you move somewhere, the first thing that you try to do is get in touch with the music, you know, find out where the music is you're gonna be grooving on. So I set the radio up, turned all the way down to the right, you know, over there where they keep the black people's music. That's just a coincidence. Everywhere you go, we'd be over in this corner here. You know, somewhere north of 13, you'll find. You know, turn over there. And I couldn't find no black music. I could not find the blues. I was wondering what the hell was going on. I said, well, you know, I come from Jackson, Tennessee, and this is New York. Maybe I need a longer radio. I turned B.B. King, I knew it was right over there, over on the other side of 16. So I went out in the street, and I run into one of the brothers on the avenue, and I said, brother, look here, what's happening? Where can I find the blues? He said, well, hell, you don't have to do nothing, just stand here.
Survival kits on wax, that's a term that Gil used.
Not my expression. Not. Well, I mean, yeah. Well, I said it.
What would happen to us when we'd be playing gigs and, you know, we'd be in different cities and people would come up to us and say, you know, I have to listen to this one song before I go to work in the morning. Or I have to listen to this one song before I get my day started.
May not have the glitter or the glamour of LA. It may not have the history or the intrigue of Bombay. But when it comes to making music and showing up making news, or people who just don't make sense and people making doom, seems a mass of contradictions pulling different ways between who have come and go and the ones who got to stay. It's a mass of irony for all the world to see. It's the nation's capital, it's Washington, D.C.
Information is what we needed most of all, you know. We needed some honest insight and information. That's what we try to deliver in our poetry and our songs. This is just as honest as we could be.
White folks discovered Africa. They claimed it fair and square. Cecil Rhodes couldn't have been robbing nobody because, hell, there wasn't nobody there. And white folks brought all the civilization because there wasn't none around. How could the folks be civilized when wasn't nobody writing nothing down?
The lineage of a spoken word and artists actually coming out and rhyming about their surroundings is nothing new.
The oral tradition is something that is instinctively valuable to us. We come from that tradition from longer than we can remember.
You have to go all the way back to the African griots and just the way that people used to pass code in the plantations of the South in America.
And still, we are victims of word games. Semantics is always a bitch.
places once referred to as underdeveloped are now called mineral rich.
The griot is the keeper of the information, the keeper of the facts, the keeper of the tradition and the family stories.
I didn't come to it by saying, you know, let me look at, you know, algebra, baseball, you know, griot, that's what I want to be, you know.
Gil Scott-Heron is certainly a griot. He's just really got a gift for the right phrase with the meaningful intent.
The poetry and the different ideas that come from that are things that I already know. The value in it comes from being able to share it to people who do not know it.
I said it was too funny. Tell me, brother, have you heard from Johannesburg?
By the time we did From South Africa to South Carolina, we had been a lot of places.
One was a way of, you know, Gil Scott-Heron making his rounds, and Johannesburg was a big record that a lot of the college students knew.
They tell me that our brothers are over there, hard to find a man. And we don't know for sure, because that Eugene Kennedy is undeniable, man.
The thing about Gil Scott-Heron being a product of the Black Power era, you know, he transcended that by bringing in a worldly discussion. You know, if you're going to talk about Johannesburg, and most people, you know, don't know anything outside Pittsburgh, or, you know, you're bringing the worldly discussion that Malcolm X brought to the table.
I found out about South Africa later than I should have, but I thought something needed to be said about the way them people were being treated over there, that you can't say nothing about your own if you don't say nothing about this, because they're doing so much worse than you are. You have a responsibility as a person to speak on things that ain't being done right.
When Gil says in Johannesburg at the end that New York is like Johannesburg, D.C. is like Johannesburg, L.A. is like Johannesburg, that's really the point of the song as far as I'm concerned. The point is that we can't look at somebody 8,000 miles away and say, oh, well, that's happening to them, but it's not happening to us. If it's happening to them, it is happening to us.
Our favorite letter in the alphabet was I. I got this problem, I got that problem, I got the blues, I got to get some money. This was no advance on brotherhood.
I hate it when the blood starts flowing, but I'm a man to see resistance. Go ahead, somebody tell me what's the word. Tell me, brother, have you heard from Johannesburg?
In 1998, we were invited to go to Johannesburg, and I was thinking, oh, what a great opportunity, because I used to get really emotional when we did that song, and when at the end when it says, what's the word, Johannesburg, and we go into Johannesburg, and I'm like, oh God, this is it, you know, this is like the crowning moment for this song, and we go, what's the word, and everybody goes, I don't know, what is the word, you know, because the song had been banned.
Somebody tell me what's the word.
What happened to protests and rage?
I think white folks ate it.
Whatever happened to the protests and the rage? Whatever happened to the voices of the same?
There's a certain attrition that kind of naturally occurs as people are able to achieve what was one of the ultimate points of the civil rights movement and even the Black Power movement, which is, you know, African Americans having access to this notion of the American dream, or, you know, the good life.
I mean, if all we wanted to be was black, hell, we was that. We could have stopped. We wanted to be Americans. That's what it was. Everybody wanted to be the same. So now we got it. Now that you got what you want, you don't want what you got.
Protest and rage has taken a back seat to things, to material goods. Protest and rage has taken a back seat to basketball players up and down the court, and football players up and down the field, and actors on TV.
We lost the focus on issues and started to concentrate on the tool as opposed to the goal.
What happened to black music as a social message is that once it was appropriated by record companies and they thought they could put soul and culture into a package, into a box,
and then regurgitated right back out to the masses, then it was limited to that, and it didn't transcend, you know, the original meaning that spawned it in the first place.
I never really had a problem with disco, but I had a problem with the type of thinking that said that it's got to be this or nothing.
As the commercial machine kind of took a hold of disco music and funk music and all of this, it became increasingly popular to take the message out of the music and just kind of boogie with it.
The period that made me say, maybe I need to take a break. Gil and I went our separate ways.
We were never not friends. We were not on the same coast at one time. I was over here and he was over on the West Coast, and then I was over on the West Coast and he was over here.
And we had actually lost contact. We had lost contact for about 15 years. We didn't really speak together until about 1994.
We went in different directions for a while, but we took different ways to get to the same place.
And I want y'all to stand up.
Well, I think most people don't know or have forgotten that it is really Stevie Wonder who single-handedly brought about the national holiday of Martin Luther King Day.
You know, it doesn't make much sense. There ought to be a law against anyone that takes offense.
Stevie wanted me to do the first 2 weeks of the tour with him. 8 dates could I do from the end of October to like the middle of November and take Bob Marley's place.
When they found out that Bob was ill, and they asked Gil to complete the tour. And I think it was during the rest of the tour that Gil really, really was able to see the scope of what Stevie, you know, had been trying to do. And I know that it touched him very deeply.
And I'm sure you would agree, what could fit more perfectly than to have a world party on a day you came to be. Happy birthday to you.
Recall the time when Reagan was elected president.
Well, the first thing I want to say is, mandate my ass.
Come with us back to those inglorious days before heroes were zeros, before fair was square, when the cavalry came straight away and all American men were like Hemingway, to the days of the wondrous B-movie.
There was a wave coming over this country. You know, wasn't that the me generation?
Reagan definitely defined an era, but he also says something very deep about just American taste and what Americans like prefer in life and leadership.
Nostalgia, that's what America wants, the good old days when we gave them hell, when the buck stopped somewhere and you could still buy something with it, to a time when movies were in black and white and so was everything else.
I mean, Gil emerges with one of the early critiques of Reagan, you know, in B-movie, just questioning, really looking more at how someone with the politics he had as a governor of California has now moved into this position of even greater power.
America wants nostalgia. They want to go back as far as they can, even if it turns out to be only last week. Not to face now or the future, but to face backwards. And yesterday was the time of our cinema heroes riding to the rescue at the last minute. The day of the man on the white horse, of the man in the white hat, coming to save America at the last moment. Someone always came to save America at the last moment. And when America found itself having a hard time facing the future, they looked for one of their heroes, someone like John Wayne. But unfortunately, John Wayne was no longer available. So they settled for Ronald the Ray Gun. And it has turned into something we can only look at, like a B-movie.
It was sad because many of us have allowed Hollywood to take charge of our lives and run everything. Like right now, they got this governor election going on with Arnold Schwarzenegger, the Terminator. I mean, that's the big joke.
As Wall Street goes, so goes the nation. And here's a look at the closing stocks. Racism is up, human rights are down. Peace is shaky, war items are hot, the house cleans all ties. Jobs are scarce, money is hard to come by, and common sense is at an all-time low.
It was depicting a situation that still exists, and Reagan was a perfect example of what we don't need if we're really serious about democracy here.
The possibility of poor people having a stepladder out of poverty, you know, I mean, those things get eradicated, you know, under Reagan, you know. And as well, it's also a time when, you know, crack comes in.
I lived through the Reagan years when, you know, Reagan decreed that ghetto kids could have ketchup as a vegetable in their lunches because, you know, they're just that inferior or not deserving. And Gil was really kind of speaking to all that.
Say really life, ain't really life, ain't really ain't nothing but a movie. Say really life, ain't really life, ain't really ain't nothing but a movie.
Such a deadening in the time of the minds of black people that Gil Scott-Heron was relating his story to everybody else because black people were pushed away from Gil. Black radio didn't support Gil Scott-Heron. The black press, you know, moved away from him because they said, oh, okay, it's passe. And so here, Gil Scott-Heron makes a profound statement, just like he would in Johannesburg, and black people don't hear it.
You know, out of that, you know, the chaos of that particular crucible comes something like hip-hop as well, you know. And, you know, in some ways, you know, I mean, hip-hop becomes a fulfillment of Gil's own ambitions.
Who gets weaker, the king or the teacher? It's not about a salary, it's all about reality. Reality. Teach and do the world good. Kings just rule and most are never understood.
One nation under God has turned into one nation under the influence of one drug. Television, the drug of a nation, breeding ignorance and feeding radiation. On television, the drug of a nation, breeding ignorance and feeding radiation.
A lot of poets who write things about certain aspects of life that are wrong and not right for us have become victims to that which they have written about themselves.
A junkie walking through the twilight, I'm on my way home.
I started hearing stories of drugs after the Midnight Band had disbanded and just left him out there. And so he had to develop, a band of rocks, it seemed, that weren't exactly the kind that played on stage.
I got caught with a gram of cocaine on 147th at Amsterdam.
Gil Scott-Heron addressing his drug problem is about as human as you could possibly get.
You listen to those lyrics closely, and there's so much about how hard it is.
You keep saying, kick it, quit it, kick it, quit it. God, but did you ever try to turn your sick soul inside out so that the world, so that the world can watch you die?
I went down, I was on my way home from the bowling alley, and I had a gram of cocaine in my pocket. It had been there for about 3 days. I had put them same pants on, went bowling, and I was on my way home, and they swept the block, and they cut me, and I had a gram of cocaine in my pocket, and they took me up, and they took me down.
There's a little bit of addict in all of us, you know, like in the last line of the bottle, where he says, everybody needs something.
addictions are about our humanity. They're about, I mean, these are, it's a funny thing to live in the United States where addiction is punished with, you know, excessive jail time.
It wasn't nothing. I'm saying I've been in America all my life. I'm used to doing time in places I don't want to be. Fuck white people in the way they treat you sometimes. That's how I dealt with it. I went up there and did that and came home. What are you gonna do? If you drafted into the army and you gotta do 4 years, what you gonna do? You gotta go do that. You going somewhere you don't wanna go. You gotta do something you don't wanna do. You got to be somewhere you don't wanna be. You in jail, you don't wanna be there. But I'd sooner be in jail than to be in Iraq fighting and killing some people I don't wanna mess with nowhere. Now I hear the sound of sirens come knifing through the gloom, but they don't know what they are doing. They can hardly understand. They're only arresting, yeah, pieces of a man.
I'm addicted to creating. I use other things from time to time. But there's nothing more important to me than writing a good song or writing a good poem or writing 2-3 pages that I can put in a book somewhere. That's what I'm addicted to. That's what I can't do without.
There's this pressure, I think, that comes not only from the creativity itself, but often from the circumstances of a person's life, that if you never really deal with those things, if you don't actually get to talk them out, well, your art comes out beautiful because, you know, you have all these aspects of the tortured artist or the person who's, you know, kind of living through all of this really difficult internal struggle.
I suffered because that's part of life. I didn't suffer from my art. I have not suffered because of what I have created. I suffered because of the time I spent doing some other shit.
And the fact that Gil says, hey, you know what, for real? Some days I beat this, and some days it whoops my ass. That's the reality of the situation.
I saw him go to pieces. He was always such a good man.
You go to a restaurant, you order some food, you don't know what the chef looks like. You're ordering that food in faith. You have no idea. He could be a troll that only does his drugs, and in between the drugs, he cooks some mean dishes. Gil Scott is a chef. He cooks some mean meals. He gives us some meals that we can eat, stuff that we can take and live off of.
When I saw him go to pieces, I saw him go to pieces.
A lot of people have called Gil the godfather of rap.
I don't ever get up and say, good morning, godfather, how you doing? I guess that's if you last a lot longer than you should have. People say, well, I remember back in the day.
His posture, figurative and literal, is just something that's so identifiable with my generation.
I wanted to be the best at whatever I did. If being the godfather is some kind of position of honor, then I'll take it.
I think that Gil will be one of the godfathers of the spoken word because you can't go back beyond him for what he has to say.
I think it depends on where you got on the train, where it came from. When I got on, it had already stopped by Paul Lawrence Dunbar and by Gene Toomer and Claude McKay and County Cullen. And I picked up things from these people that I passed on to other folks, and they got it from me, so they thought it was mine. And I hope I didn't mislead them by claiming nothing was mine. It wasn't.
Gil had fallen off as far as some people are concerned, and all of a sudden comes out this little CD on a cassette called Spirits, and Gil is kicking it. And the message to the young rappers was very, very important.
Hey, yeah, we're the same brothers from a long time ago. We was talking about television and doing it on the radio. What we did was to help our generation realize they got to get out there and get busy because it wasn't going to be televised.
Because a lot of the hip-hop artists today don't read and they don't study their history, they don't understand that what's motivating them to even open up their big mouths is the fact that somebody tried to shut their mouths.
Yeah, when message to the messenger, you get the feeling that he's talking to, well, he's talking to me and, you know, a lot of my counterparts.
He was kind of saying, there's a lot out there that can take and co-opt this music and turn it into something that isn't going to be beneficial to anybody.
It's like, okay, if you're going to speak to the people, you got to be the people too. You just can't like speak to the people and like, you know, don't know how to change a flat tire.
Because if you're going to be speaking for a whole generation and you know enough to try and handle their education, be sure you know the real deal about past situations and ain't just repeating what you heard on the local TV station.
I was talking to the young people going into spoken word who need to learn some music and need to learn who they represent, because whether they like it or not, they represent our community, and they have a great influence on the other youngsters like themselves, and they can make some changes if they care to, if they're brave enough.
Sometimes they tell lies and put them in a truthful disguise, but the truth is, that's why we said it wouldn't be televised. They don't know what to say to our young folks, but they know that you do. And if they really knew the truth, why would they tell you?
In terms of keeping the genre alive, you couldn't have a bigger palette of keeping the spoken word alive now. It's called rap music.
It's bigger than
One thing about music, when it hit, you feel no pain. White folks say it controls your brain. I know better than that. That's game, man. We ready for that. Two soldiers headed to pack. Matter of fact, who got it?
What?
And where my army at? Rather attack and not react.
Sticks and stones will break your bones, but words will do permanent damage.
B, before we came to this country, we were kings and queens, never porch monkeys. There was empires in Africa called Kush, Timbuktu, where every race came to get books to learn from black teachers who taught Greeks and Romans, Asian Arabs, and gave them gold. When gold was converted to money, it all changed. Money then became empowerment for Europeans.
Words arranged the right way can do, you know, permanent good.
Wrong with the world, mama. People living like they ain't got no mamas. I think the whole world's addicted to the drama. Only attracted to things that'll bring the trauma. Overseas, yeah, we trying to stop terrorism. But we still got terrorists here living in the USA, the big CIA, the Bloods and the Crips and the KKK.
You know, resistant hip-hop, political hip-hop, as it were, I mean, still goes on. And a lot of people who are part of that don't just consider themselves rappers, you know what I mean? They consider themselves activists.
Your revolution will not happen between these thighs. Your revolution will not happen between these thighs. The real revolution ain't about booty size, the Versaces you buys, or the Lexus you drives.
A lot of times people can say in poems things that they can't say to you personally, but they need to get that information across. I've been writing poetry for a long, long time, and I still feel as though some of the things that I said a long time ago are relevant now. So I don't think poetry would ever lose its place in the community. I don't think that communicating will ever go away. I think it's something that's more important than ever.
I think that that what he set out to do was to write some good music, was to write some good books, to write some good poems, to heal, and to inform. And I think that he's done that.
I ain't become the Dalai Lama, but I ain't missed a whole bunch of shit. My grandmother taught me that if you could help somebody, why not? If you could help them, why wouldn't you? I don't know who else I could have been. I don't know anybody else I would have rather been.
The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by Masterpiece Theater and will not star Marla Maples as Tom Cruise or Oprah as Miss Peggy.
And women will not care if Dick finally got down with Jane on Search for Tomorrow, because black people will be in the streets looking for a brighter day.
NBC. Will not be able to predict the winner at 8:32 on reports from 29 districts.
You will not have to worry about a dove in your bedroom, a tiger in your tank, or a giant in your toilet bowl.
The theme song will not be written by Jim Webb or Francis Scott Key, or sung by Glenn Campbell, Tom Jones, Johnny Cash, Engelbert Humperdinck, or Rare Earth.
The revolution will not just do it. The revolution will not make you slim fast, because the revolution will not be televised, brother.
This revolution is not a rerun, brothers. This revolution is live.